can for Dawn, and if you don't get a chance to have a conversation, then let's just go right over to the table afterwards and line up. Definitely wants to talk to everybody as much as possible. So without further ado, let's bring out the band. You are all here to see our very favorite hobbit, at least mine, Dominic Monaghan.
That's fine. 65%, I'm kind of like, that was a good day of working. this hashtag. If I watch it, it comes down to like this. I should have done this, I should have done that, I didn't use that reaction. So I just don't watch it. I'm not seeing one of the things, any of those films would be a good 17, 18 years.
But a lot of the times when you're on the set, it's green screen, right? So how do you know if the final scene turned out really well, or if like the special effects turned out the way you kind of envisioned them?
Yeah, I definitely have watched it and do watch everything that I'm in so that I can talk about it. But I'm talking about usually once or in single digits. I've seen Wolverine, for instance, you're expected to go to the credit office. I've seen those movies probably 4 or 5 times in their entirety. I had no real need to watch them again. I'm just like, maybe when I have kids, maybe when I have grandkids, I'll be at this point. I don't know why I get out of it, apart from the problem has me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
his ability to kind of manipulate time and space and multiverses, and he's kind of a big thinker and stuff. So yeah, I would say Dr. Strange, but what about you, Arp? And if you could be a superhero?
I would be
Wolverine. Awesome. Excellent. Thanks, Arp. That's a great question.
Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah, around the world too, right? Yeah. Thanks for the question.
Because he was under a lot of pressure, so he did not
necessarily appreciate and wanted to go in artistic directions that ABC maybe didn't want to. So he was like, I might be. And when he told me that, I said, well, if you leave, I'll leave with you. And that would have been the end of season three. He was like, oh, well, cool, I'll let you know if I leave. Now, as we got into season three, I had kind of said to David, you know, this kind of backwards and forwards, he's on drugs, seems to have kind of played out. And at that point, Charlie was doing a lot of like, well, Claire, you go out on an adventure, I'll hold on to the baby, and then you come back and tell me about it. And I was expressing a few frustrations of like, I don't really want to be a babysitter while I was on those adventures. This is supposed to be a major character in the show. So David came to me about halfway through season three and said, I think I found a way to plan a really great story arc for you that brings you back into the center of the story. It has you die and then you see the film. And I said, all right, let's do it. You know, like, that's going to be the best crack of the whip that we're going to get. And I was happy to go down that road. You know, I think you can make a strong argument and say that maybe Charlie has the best exit of any character on Lost. And the way that they did it with Michael Cicchino's incredible score and the slow motion stuff, and the fact that they kept this idea that Charlie was going to die, and then eventually it happened. I thought it worked really well. I have seen it, not in its entirety in terms of my sat down and watched the episode, but I've seen the clips of, you know, Charlie croaking, because it's consistently in the conversation for best TV death ever. So sometimes I'm on the TV and they'll show that little sequence.
Oh, I thought it went down great. I thought it was really beautiful.
I like the whole like sign of the cross thing. It's like maybe the red thing to the world.
Thank you so much.
Thanks,
Nate. Apology for the spoilers.
Oh, yeah.
Well, it's like 15 years ago. Do you know what I mean?
You don't know this one.
So this is actually going to go perfectly in line with that question.
Well,
so Lost was... You know, Lost came out, I was 12 years old, it was a big thing, my entire family watched it. Keyword, Charlie was my favorite character, my sister's favorite character, she had a massive crush on you. So to make her really jealous, would you write not Penny's boat on my hand?
Sure. No worries. That's what I write when someone comes over to us and says, Lost, I always write not Penny's boat, which means we'll be like, one of the plenty of stuff, you know. Yeah. Maybe it'll come out in the 50th anniversary or something. You know, I'll ask Pete. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, all these people here at CEDIAC, and we love the work. I'm just curious, what are some of the things in the property out there that you think out that you would show up to be Mr.
Yeah, man, I'm a major nerd. I'm like a card carrying, flag waving nerd for a bunch of stuff, and I love it. I've been playing League of Legends now for a couple of years. I would certainly go to like the World's Championships and watch that thing in San Francisco this year. I just said to the ladies of Fringe, go up to San Francisco and go check it out. It seems to be down. I go to a lot of reptile and invertebrate expos in and around California, you know, like see if people are selling anything interesting, see if I can pick up any cool supplies or cool things from like tanks. I'm a massive Manchester United fan, so obviously I fly around the world going and seeing Manchester United play. Pay a lot of money to do that. I like Alexander McQueen. This is Alexander McQueen. So if there's events in and around where I live that has something to do with Alexander McQueen, since I'm not sure today. I really like that TV show Arcane, which is based on characters out of League of Legends. You know, they're so good. Bill and I toured the Riot offices, you know, Star Wars fans. What was it doing with Star Wars? And we didn't have a chance to like hang out with Anthony Daniels and Sticky R2 Unit and all that kind of stuff. I love it. I have friends who are a little kind of reluctant to claim that they are geeks and nerds about stuff, but like, it just means you're really into something. Like, it's great to have passion about stuff. So, plenty of things. David, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Almost had my questions called it. But first, I want to thank you very much for making my engagement yesterday special.
Oh, yeah, that was a big deal. He proposed in front of the four hobbits when we did a boat tour between. You know what was scary about that? You might not have seen it because you were in the moment.
Yeah.
But when you said, will you marry me? She kind of went, I don't believe this is happening. And I was like, oh, this has gone really bad. I'm going to have to leave the room. We all witnessed it. But it was just kind of like, I can't believe it. Oh, yes, I will marry. Oh, my God.
Just shocked.
Very shocked. Well, congrats.
It's so nice to hear you play D&D.
Yeah.
You know, 17 years.
Nice. I just like playing Magic the Gathering. I've only played a couple of games. Yeah. But I shamelessly put something out on Instagram where I was like, hey, I do not have a deck, I'm welcome to build a deck. If anyone has duplicates, they're going to give me stuff from their deck. So people were like, hey, I'll send you a few cards. Thank you. Love it.
Knowing that you play D&D Mary is now my favorite hobbit.
I was on a Mary yesterday.
But I wanted to ask, so for her, that was very special. Lord of the Rings is like her favorite. You know, big Star Wars is mine. What is your favorite movie, or maybe something that's so big that like shaped you as a person, changed your life the way that Lord of the Rings did?
Yeah, cool. Do you mean outside of a franchise, or are you looking for a franchise?
Either. Whichever is most important to you. Like, what's something that was big for you?
Yeah, I mean, the reason why I'm an actor is Star Wars, because I watched that when I was a kid and worked out that these were performers and asked my dad about it. My dad kind of educated me, and then I went on this kind of journey at that point when I was 8, 9 years old, thinking, oh, I'm going to be an actor. I'm going to go about that. So the most influential movies in terms of the path of my life, certainly Star Wars. But my favorite movie is Apocalypse Now. So, yeah, man. And I'll watch that probably a couple of times a year and always see something new in it, and that's incredible.
But of course, we're with you, Dom.
Thank you, my friend, and see you.
So we've got about 10 minutes, so...
I will try to be faster. I'm a big proponent of the Gone Too Soon show, Flash Forward. I was wondering if you, Dom, suddenly passed out for 137 seconds. What do you think you would see in that time that you were passed out this week?
Well, I mean, without revealing my sources, I have gone to some places of having been passed out for a significantly long amount of time and gone to some interesting places. Normally I've had a couple of near-death experiences where I just have gone elsewhere. But I've also specifically put myself in places of flying around galaxies and stuff. So, I don't know, man. I'm open to everything. My favorite feeling in the world is feeling humble. I love that feeling of being exposed to something so much significantly bigger and significant than you, and having the experience of feeling super small. So, in those moments, I always feel like, wow, I'm just a tiny little speck of dust in this galaxy, and that's beautiful. So, I don't know. I'm open to everything, but I like to play around with those things too.
Nice.
Thanks, man.
First off, Ali, welcome to Dallas. We're all glad to have you here.
Thanks.
Well, I love Lord of the Rings, and you're one of my favorite characters. But one of your smaller roles was in the movie X-Men Origins Wolverine. My question is, how was that experience for you?
Yeah, that was great. That was super fun. I was kind of in and around shooting Lost already, having come to all the other Lost, certainly close to it. I spent some guys in the call, Joe Katz, who had been working over in that studio. And he just emailed me one day and he was like, hey man, are you like free for the next kind of 6-8 weeks or so? Are you shooting? And I said, no, I'm not shooting anything, I'm kind of looking at stuff. I said, I think we might have a goal for you in X-Men, if you're into it. And I was like, oh, that's great. I love those characters, I love that world, where they shoot, so I'm just gonna shoot in Sydney. So then within that day, they got in touch with my agent and they were like, here's the part, here's the offer, let us know we're done with this. I read it, it was fun. Flew out to Sydney that week. I was out there rehearsing with the Leo Schreiber for like 2 or 3 days, and then we went on set. I just hang out with Hugh Jackman, whose movie The Fountain is one of my other favourite films of all time. I absolutely love that film. He was an absolute gentleman. He was a great cast. Hanging out with Will.i.am at the time was recording Michael Jackson's album, which was just a whole thing about. And Ryan Reynolds, who was a super lovely guy. He was a great thing to do, you know. I had a blast. I was there for probably 8 weeks, in and out, shot the whole thing, left. Thanks, Steve.
So this is going to be our last question. Oh. You guys didn't get a chance. Oh. You'll be here, table for
yes, yes, yes. Nobody's signing on my table. You can ask me the question.
Yeah. So please do.
Sorry.
Right. No pressure for you, but it has to be good.
Yeah.
I think it's open.
Okay.
My name is Rachel. Thank you so much for all your work. Story that helped me for things. I was pregnant during the film and made my daughter home. And it helped my husband who's sitting right over there in cancer treatment. And it's just a very special energy that you and the others brought. And I think a big part of that was that you, all of you, dug so deep to bring your real selves and genuine energy. That the chemistry was so good on set, and that's part of what makes it so special, and we can all feel that. And I'd love to hear a little bit about how you all helped each other achieve that, because it's not easy as an actor to bring such a genuine feeling that the audience can share.
Yeah, it's a great question. They cast the films really well. And with a lot of care and attention, I think Pete and his team were acutely aware that certainly if they cast the fellowship correctly in terms of the vibe, then everything else was just going to kind of slot in place. In casting Elijah as an 18-year-old man who had been working a lot, but coming to the table with a huge amount of professionalism and the correct attitude that you should have on set, which is just like, I want to do the best job, but I also want to try and be the best person. From there, because he's number one on the call sheet, and he's the ring bearer, and he's Frodo, you can't really get anyone kind of acting out and messing around, you know? So then you Sean Astin, who was obviously desperate to do a good job and help out Elijah and anyone else as much as he could. Then we kind of became besties within probably a week. We were something like just sleeping over each other's
houses and going out for dinner and spending an extraordinary amount of time with each other.
So when you've got those four, the kind of nucleus, the heart of the story, the emotional core, comes from a place of genuine love, friendship, and companionship. It all just kind of spreads out, you know. So I think the casting was excellent. We were tired. We were working very hard. We knew we were working on something ambitious and huge. And we all just, regardless of what we were going through offset or how tired we felt on set, we all wanted to maintain this vibe of we're in a kind of gang, a supportive gang with each other. We're all going on this journey together as a brotherhood, as a fellowship. It wasn't that long into shooting that we started to come up with the idea of a tattoo. I honestly thought he was going to get shot down almost immediately. Orlando had a tattoo. He was like, I'm thinking of getting a tattoo while we're in New Zealand because it's like a place of a tattoo. And I was like, dude, I'll get a tattoo when you get a tattoo. And he said, well, why don't we get all this similar or the same? And I was like, I'm down. So then I asked Billy. Billy's like, I'm down. And I thought, at this point, Sean Astin's going to say no, or Ian McKellen's going to say no, or Vigo, all of them. I'm like, yeah, let's do it. Because they wanted to cement this really special thing too. So with that mindset of we're all going to get a tattoo, but having not actually done it to be able to film it, we all knew, well, if we're going to brand this onto our body, we want to behave in a way that we have a little bit of integrity, so when we look at a tattoo, we're like, oh yeah, I did the right thing there. I do think that that tattoo kind of mindset really pushed us into keeping that same attitude throughout all of the film. Yeah, right? There's my Elvin tattoo, and then there's Oscar Wilde underneath. Yeah, thanks you dudes. Thanks a lot. Thanks for coming, everyone. That's really sweet.
So really quick.
Oh yeah.
We wanted to feed into this giant nerd persona we have going on here, and the lovely and wonderful Tyler Hurst is here to induct you into their group.
Oh, sweet. Oh, this was going to happen last time.
Well, it's happening now.
Woo-hoo. What's up, guys? Hi. Okay, thanks.
First, I'd like to acknowledge the performance of Beaumont Kim in Star Wars The Rise of Skywalker. On behalf of the 501st Legion, the Star Garrison, and the North Texas Squad, we'd like to induct you as an honorary member of Star Wars, the contributions to Star Wars Universe.
Thank you so much!
Thank you so much. It's very, very sweet of you guys, and it is an honor.
Thanks.